for all the gory details. They created a huge integration test suite and validation system, which I should blog about when I find the time. And in the current development version, they killed Genomin, the library that was the low-level engine for the PCV engine for the past decade. They replaced it by a new, much simpler non-linear engine directly to GES, the GSTM Editing Services library. Again, this will reduces the chances of the application freezing or randomly dying on you while you're editing, which is nice. Thibaut recently rewrote the timeline to be purely GTK because, well, Clutter doesn't have much of a future. We should be ready for Wayland. He is also testing Matthew Walter's GTK Video Sync widget as a replacement for GL Image Sync widget, which was a replacement for Clutter's Image Sync widget, which was a replacement for XB Image Sync or something like that. So Matthew, if you're in the room, no pressure, but your widget has to be perfect this time. As far as I understand, that last point combined with actually needing serious testing to be sure that we're not releasing crap is the only thing blocking FPTV release for 0.95. In theory, this release would be much more reliable, but for that to happen, we need help. We need help for testing because I don't have a huge amount of time to do it. And so if you're interested in helping the FPTV project, please come talk to me during this week. I'll show you how. It's really easy. You don't even have to compile the damn thing. And you don't even need to create crazy debug logs or anything. We have an amazing system called Scenarios that you can allow the developers to reproduce exactly your issues, your freezes, your hangs, or whatever. You just have to provide a project file and some samples, and you're done. So that's it.
Hi, so I speak to you about Tails and the relation between Tails and GNOME, how we use GNOME to do Tails. First, what is Tails? Tails is an acronym for the Amazigh Incognito Live System, and it's a live distribution which aims at providing privacy for anyone, anywhere. So how do we hope to achieve these goals? Tails is a live system, operating system, which means it's not intended to be installed onto a hard drive, but to be installed on an external media such as a USB stick or an SD card, or could also be burned onto a DVD or started as a virtual machine. And we provide anonymity and censorship sync convention. To do that, we route all network traffic through the Tor network. Tails also aims at leaving no trace on the computer you boot it on, and unless you explicitly ask it for it, and include all the state of art cryptographic tools to encrypt files, instant messaging, email, and whatever is available. So it's a very specific use case, but in its use case, it's the most widespread solution, and we have about 13,000 boots connected to the network a day nowadays. So Tails is based on GNOME for its desktop experience. This is a screenshot of our development version because we're based on Debian Stable, and our current stable version is still based on Debian Wheezy. It ships on old GNOME, but we are working on porting to Jesse, and we'll ship for the first time GNOME Shell in its classic mode, as you can see. We had to tune a few things to make GNOME work for our use case, and in particular, we have written a custom GTM client which used the upstream GTM server, but we have a non-tilde custom interface. That's the old version. We are working on a new one which should follow the GNOME 3 guidelines. And why do we have to do that? It's because we have a live system which is supposed to be easy to use without having any configuration done, but we need, before the session is started, we need to enable the user to unlock an encrypted partition in which they can store some data like PGP keys or some documents. And we need to be able to set up some specific network options like Tor bridges or MAC address randomization and obviously localization. So it was really convenient for us to be able to do that in a graphical environment, but before the actual user session is loaded. We also follow the GNOME guidelines, and especially the GNOME Human Interface guideline when we have to write custom software or adapt existing software. And our documentation team use the GNOME documentation guidelines, and all these proved to be very useful. So thanks a lot to all the people that contributed to those GNOME guidelines. Of course, there's still room for improvements. So here is a small list of things that could be better for us in GNOME. We provide virtual keyboards, not only for accessibility, but also to protect against hardware keyloggers. And unfortunately, GNOME virtual keyboard is not as good as it could be. Especially, it lacks layout super localization. So currently we use Florence, which is not GNOME at all, and not integrated well, but we wait for better support, and perhaps we'll help if we have time. There is also issues related to OpenPGP integration. There are recently been improvements in TIOS, but for us it still lacks TLS for HKP support, which is retrieving the encrypted the connection to the key source, and the GNOME Compute agents, as far as I know, still lacks smart card support. And we currently ship a custom, well, GNOME panel applet currently for record encryption and decryption to be able to use OpenPGP in webmail in a kind of safe way. That's what user want. So this week, we intend to port into a real TTK standalone application. Another feature that our users want is TrueCrypt volume support. That is currently in crypt setup, and we hopefully arrive in, we hope it arrives in new disks. Happy documentation.
So I'd like to say a few words of what we want to achieve in the Pontarius project. Okay, brilliant, thanks. Okay, so it's basically around the notion of end-to-end security of your internet communication. So basically, what we would like to have is, the basic notion is to reveal as little as possible to third parties, so it's basically strong encryption between you and your contacts. Okay, so I'll click. So basically, you know, we believe that, you know, free software is a necessity for this kind of security, where you can basically, where we as a community can audit the software and that it's running on our local machines, so that basically we can have trust in the whole stack, like from the software all the way down to the hardware. And we're also integrating the notion of a social network, which like to enable you to easily and securely connect to your friends and find your friends. And we're also thinking about simple concepts, simple workflows, and high level, I mean, an API that is not in any way unnecessarily complex, so to make it easy for developers to use services on top of this for applications. So basically, this is what we have so far. We have built a prototype to show, like, illustrate the idea. We have built it on top of XMPP for communication, for decentralized communication. GNU-BG for generating keys and for signing sessions. A version of a protocol built upon off the record for establishing these sessions and for properties such as deniability. And exposing it all as a Dbus API to build upon. So here are two pictures that I hope are visible. Basically, just prototype UI. To the left, you see a contact list. It's just the core of the application so far. And to the right, you can see off the record challenges, which are questions that you can send to your contact to increase the confidence that the person is who he or she claimed to be. So basically, we are building this vision as a service to run on your machine, and we are building a UI and optimizing it for GNOME. But basically, you know, there are a lot of moving parts here, and it's just a prototype. But we would be very happy to hear your feedback. And if there are any UI developers that are interested in hearing more, contributing, you know, if you have any questions, please feel free to just approach me and we'll have a chat. Okay, thank you.
Talks from my students, but maybe you aren't really aware fully of what is Koala actually at the core. And first thing I'm going to do is clone our logo because we are proud. Koala is a code analysis framework which basically unites the language independent parts of all linters, right? And we are trying to ease the creation of code analysis and trying to put in as much as possible to ease this task as language independently as possible. So why should we actually use Koala? With Koala you can actually concentrate on the algorithm type. Koala handles the user interaction for you and helps you with parsing the stuff. And the user can actually use a graphical user interface or a command line user interface. You can export data to JSON if you're doing scientific work. I just did my bachelor thesis with it, and it's just awesome to be able to just export the stuff. And you just write one single function which does it. And again, this is completely language independent. And now the plans for the future, and this is the great big ultimate goal, is we want to create a universal abstract syntax tree thing. And there is already scientific work about this out there. We can use it, we just need to turn it into production usable things. Of course, there's more work involved and it will be hard to do. But this is our major thing we want to achieve, and if you're interested in all that kind of stuff, please just go ahead, come on our Jitter channel, ask us, speak to me, and hopefully we can avoid writing each linter and each analysis multiple times for every language yet again and again and again. Thanks for your attention.
I don't have slides, so. So I'm Cosimo, I work for Endless. As you've seen yesterday, we make hardware at Endless, and just want to share with you like some of the things that I've learned while doing that. So what does it take to make a hardware product? Turns out it takes a whole lot. It takes so many people to make a hardware product. Starting from the box might have different sorts of papers. And you know, the ink that you print on the paper on the box, these are all going to be made by different people, possibly in different countries. Then you open the box and inside you will find, I don't know, some plastic envelopes, some cables. The cables will have some metal components. You have to choose the length of the cable, you have to choose the brand of the cable. These are all made by different vendors, and when you make a hardware product, you can choose each one of those individually. So imagine how many people just going to making the cables and the plastic wrappings and all of that, and you haven't even started scratching the surface of the hardware. You have, you know, like a desktop computer, like the one that we seen yesterday, and you know, the case is made out of plastics. The plastics are probably gonna be made, there's gonna be at least two or three different kind of plastics in a product like the one that we make. And each one of them is yet again a different vendor. You open it up, even before you get to the motherboard, you need to understand that the motherboard sits on a metal surface or something like that that is made by yet another different vendor that you need to understand and to figure out which one you want to get cheaper, effectively. Who does all of this? If you're, you know, a company like Apple, or if you're a company like, I don't know, like Lenovo, you probably have your own factories that drive this whole process. If you're a smaller company like Endless, you sort of do the same thing that, you know, you go to a tailor to have like a custom-made suit or something like that. So you go to this, you know, companies called ODM, and they're design manufacturers. So that means that you go to them, you tell them exactly what you want, and they will find out all these little, you know, vendors that will source all the parts for you. And you know, you haven't even actually started doing the hardware. So what does it take to actually make the hardware? Well, you first need to define what goes into your product. And that follows a very strict process that has a bunch of steps. You start with the definition of your product that is in a document called PRD, Product Requirements Definition. You get quotes by maybe different vendors, different ODMs that can just, you know, compete on who makes the cheapest version of your custom suit, effectively. And then you start this whole process, and then you start actually making hardware. They know how to make it, and they will start spinning up boards for you. So the first boards will be total crap and probably will not work. But after a few months that you witness this process, probably a few boards that will be able to put up some sort of software will start showing up. And those are, you know, like pre-production. They don't even have a name. Like, you know, they're just like throwaway boards, basically. After that, you start going into a process that goes through the phase of EVT, which is the engineering evaluation. I don't remember what it stands for. You can find it on Wikipedia. And there's EVT1 and EVT2. And at each one of these iterations, you start fixing little defects that are on your board. Let's say, you know, you have your USB, I don't know, like line has an interference with the wireless or something like that. And you start identifying all these things, so it's missing a resistor here, or I don't know, like something like that. Typically, it takes at least 3 or 4 of these spins to fix all the defects. And of course, finding a defect, like the farther you are into the process, the harder it is, and the more expensive it is to fix. If you let one very, very big defect slip all the way through production, so after 3 or 4 of these cycles, you're basically screwed. You have to start all over, stop the production line, and that is really, really, really expensive. And you haven't even gotten to think about the software. So the software process, in order for the software to work on it, it needs to be aligned, stuff like the release cycle of the process needs to be aligned with the expectations that your design house, your ODM, will have at each one of these steps. something specific that I think in GNOME we could do to help this process. One of the sort of like last checkpoints in your production is to do QA on your software before you commit to production. And actually, it turns out that, you know, GNOME could do a whole lot to facilitate QA on our own platform, because we define our own behaviors. We know that when you open the control center and you go to the touchpad panel, you have to see the touchpad, and that, I'm out of time. That's it.
Summit 2016, as you know. I'm going to explain you 5W1H. It's what? It's Genome Asia Summit 2016. It happens in May this year. And that was happened near from the capital city of Indonesia. It's not in Jakarta. It's in Depok. It's about 2 hours. No. Set 50 minutes. Yeah, I don't know. It's not my city because I live in another city. That's near. It's like 20 minutes from Jakarta. And then who are they? They are consist of. This is the interesting one, because they are attended by more than 300 people. They are including the speakers and then the volunteer, the attendees. The attendees is not only a Genome user. Usually, eventually in Indonesia, if they hosted an IT event, there will become a lot of people, even if they are not part of it. Something like that. But they will be going to interesting in that way. If we hosted a very creative, a very big, and a very mesmerizing event. So something like that. And then things about Genome Asia that we help event is not only for Genome user. They know it's Genome Asia Summit, but there's. It's not like all of it, you know, just like this. I've experienced the different things here, because everybody is talking about, you know, some. I mean, everybody knows it, but it's not. No one come and ask me what is it, you know, nothing like that here. I got a lot of questions in Genome Asia Summit. Somebody will ask, what is Genome? I attend this event because it looks like an IT event, something like that. And then why it has to be another Genome Asia? Because maybe a lot of people in Indonesia need an introduction. Introduction is very important part of marketing, yeah. Again. And then there will be, this is one for me. There will be a release party for the Genome next year, and next September but we will have it in the October, because the September is like some kind of like religion things stuff. Yeah, it will be in October. That's why the Maroon 5 had to cancel the event in Indonesia. Okay, thank you so much for having me. I am really happy to have you.
I'm not totally prepared, so let's see how this goes. There's good news too, don't worry about that. I had an epiphany last year sometime, which is that fonts on Linux aren't that great. Which is to say, not that the fonts themselves are bad, open source fonts are great, but a lot of the revolution really came through web fonts, and we haven't totally figured out how to take advantage of them on the desktop. And there's a couple of different dimensions to that. For instance, it's sort of hard to install a font, particularly a web font that you find somewhere. And then once you get installed, you don't necessarily know anything about it. Like, if there's an update, how are you going to find out about that? You can work on that. There's a ton of fonts out there that are under open source licenses, but you can't necessarily develop them with free tools. Years and years ago, there was a really good font manager for desktop Linux, and I reused this from Graphics. We need to point out that Pierre is not the one that's dead, it's Font Matrix. On the other hand, there's missing metadata for all these things, even if they are packaged. The good news, though, is that they're working on this. So Richard Hughes and his AppData posse have at least made some push to get metadata for fonts, and there's a GNOME Font Manager project that's active now, and build tools are getting work, things like that. Pango can actually even activate some open type features. The thing I want to talk about are those open type features, because there's a bunch of them, and they make the fonts smart. And what does that mean? That means alternative shapes and little spacing adjustments. They have semantic meaning, so a swash you can just turn on with the swash feature. And if you have ligatures that are not standard, you can add those yourself. There's also randomization and cool things like that. That's how typewriter fonts work. They look a little different every time you type a C, because it's randomized. And font designers love to do these things. This is from E.B. Garamond, which is a great example because there's a bunch of features in this font and they're all really well explained in the documentation, but small caps and superscripts and subscripts and things, alternates to Q, you see there, a lot of different variations of the Q. So that sort of thing. It turns out people really do care about this. Last year at A-Type-I, the big type conference, there was like almost a riot and people rushing the stage during a Q&A session talking about how bad Adobe's implementation of font features is. And then other end of the spectrum, at Apple's Worldwide Developer Conference, I guess, they showed that in the clock, the colon sort of adjusted its spacing when it was next to the numbers, and people went nuts for that. And that's a standard open type feature. We should be able to do that. We can do better than Apple can. And so we've started actually working on this. I convinced a bunch of people to get together at Legal Graphics meeting on the contents creation side, and we want to work on sort of using the same UI patterns for accessing these features. So if you work on an application that lets users make documents, you might care about this. The open source OpenType group on GitHub so far is just sort of documenting what needs to be done. Eventually though, that stuff, like Pango can access some of those features now, so if you're writing a GTK app, you should get a lot of this for free, but some of them may be things that you need to think about. So feel free to join the group and we'll talk about that. And the middle link there is the reference. You can see some features in use. But there's stuff that may hit your app even if you don't think you're doing graphics and font specific stuff. So stay tuned. Thanks.
You can fly fixed wings, but it's extremely boring. The fact is that you just need to learn to take off and land, and in between, you can put it on autopilot, and there's nothing to do. the helicopters, you're a cool person. Because you can do something that's called hovering. You can be in one place, you can land anywhere you like. You're going, you need to go to the toilet, you just stop anywhere. it's really cool. You find a nice cafe on the way, you drop down, land there, and you go to the coffee place. A lot of information I'll give you is UK specific, but this has been really very well internationalized, and there's been treaties and stuff, so a lot of it applies, or at least it's very similar in other countries, except maybe for the US, where. first thing is that you need a private pilot license, which allows you to go on your own, and you take your friends with you, of course. And for that, firstly, people think it's very difficult. It's not as difficult as you might imagine. I started learning to drive and fly at the same time, and at least in London, driving is a lot more difficult. When you're in the air, people don't come and like in front of you without. it's not as dangerous as you think. If you stop the engine, actually it's a normal procedure to stop the engine to learn how to land if your engine goes off. So it's not as dangerous as you might think. It's just a glider when the engine is off. It is very expensive. That's very true. So if you really need to be devoted to it if you want to do it. I had to take some bank loans to make it possible. You need at least 50 flying hours. Usually it goes towards 60, but if you're very good at it, like I am, so you. You need to pass 9 exams. I have only passed 3 right now, but there'll be more. You need to choose an aircraft. Like you can see, a very cool guy. So that's the basic model. That's an American machine, but it's really outdated. And nowadays, the best one is the Cabri G2. It's a French invention, and I guess it's because it's French, so the rotor is spinning the opposite direction. So the pedal controls is also different. So yeah, anyway. So but if you want to actually have a pleasant experience, you want to fly this one. Although it makes flying so easy that you are almost not doing anything, so maybe it's not as fun. After you have your private license, you can go on your own. You can fly, but you can't make any money out of it. But then you can go for commercial, which requires 150 lessons or so hours. So you can fly on your own. You can share the price with your nice friends, as I'm hoping that I'll get. But you might think that after all that money spent, you will get a lot of money in return when you become a commercial pilot. That's not true at all. The first jobs you will get is very like low paid, like £20,000 a year or something like that. But if you do another course which costs like £50,000, then you get good salary. But of course, by the time you get to commercial, you're broke. Thanks for coming.
That's it for lightning talks. We have a great turnout this year. And next up, we've got Sean, but this time without projectiles.
Are you sure?
They've been confiscated.
Good. Hit the timer. 5 minute closing. I'm gonna read all of them. Okay, so now comes the wonderful annual tradition of closing out WADEC when it's only half finished. I'm told we had 157 people come this year, so thank you everybody for coming. I really want to thank our sponsors. Nobody pays a very high registration fee, and it does cost money to put WADEC on, and we absolutely can't do that without the support from our sponsors. So our gold sponsors, Google and Red Hat, our silver sponsors, Egalia and OpenSUSE, bronze sponsors, Git Cafe, C-File, and Ubuntu, and our supporting sponsors, OwnCloud, CodeThink, and Endocode, thank you to our sponsors. So sponsors provide money, which is wonderful, but this conference cannot happen without the local organizing committee and the volunteers. We rely really heavily on our volunteers. We burn them out every year. So could we bring all the volunteers up on stage, please?
It starts at 10.